who will provide the most up-to-date information on the public health impact of COVID-19 on Baltimore County and at the state level. We also have speakers who will be discussing mental health issues and the 2020 census. So thank you again for joining us. And for those who have called in, you can watch the town hall live on Facebook at Senator Hedelman's Facebook page. And now I'd like to turn things over to Senator Hedelman.
Thank you so much, Dana. We appreciate all of you being here tonight with us. I'm very happy that we have the distinguished panelists that we have tonight. And I would like to just explain that people had an opportunity to register, but you didn't have to register tonight because you can watch live on Facebook Live on my Senate page. People who did register had an opportunity to submit questions that we were able to provide to the panelists so that they will have a sense of some of the issues that are coming their way when they deliver their remarks. You will also have an opportunity to ask questions via the Facebook Live, via the Facebook page. So we'll monitor that during this evening's program, and we can ask questions of each of the panelists when we have the chance. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Delegate John Cardin. Thanks.
Thank you, Delegate Hedelman. Thank you, Delegate Stein. Thank you, Delegate Belcastro, for all participating in and allowing me to join on this. Just very quickly, the agenda tonight. We have leaders in health and mental wellness at both the state and local level, as Senator Hedelman has already said. I apologize if I misstated that. I'd like to just tell you who they are very quickly. We have Dr. Gregory Branch, Baltimore County Health Department, the commissioner from the Baltimore County Department of Health and Human Services, longstanding and excellent leader for us in the county. Dr. Josh Sharfstein, not only a friend, but also the Vice Dean of Public Health, a practice at Johns Hopkins School of Public Health, and the former Secretary of Maryland's Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. Caitlin Mulrine, Deputy Director of the National Alliance for Mental Illness, NAMI Baltimore, the Baltimore chapter. We also have Sevetra Peoples, Coordinator for Baltimore County Government Census, who will give us a brief update on the census and answer any questions that we may have. We look forward to hearing from all of you. Now it's my opportunity to turn it over to Delegate Belcastro to introduce our first speaker.
Hi, everyone. This is Delegate Lisa Belcastro. While I have you, I want to take a moment to plug our next town hall, which will be happening on May 26th at 7:30 p.m. We're going to be covering the topic of education and the June 2nd mail-in primary election. Our confirmed speakers so far include Dr. Williams, Superintendent of Baltimore County Public Schools, and Cheryl Pastor, Board of Education member representing District 2. Next, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Gregory Branch. Dr. Branch is the Director of Health and Human Services in Baltimore County. He has played a large role in the COVID-19 response in our area and will be able to provide us with valuable local insight. Dr. Branch, thank you for joining us.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Delegate Belcastro. I'm Dr. Branch. I'm the Director of Health and Human Services for Baltimore County and the Health Officer for Baltimore County. First, let me take this opportunity to thank the District 11 delegation for inviting me this evening. In addition, I'd like to thank County Executive Olszewski for his leadership during this pandemic. I always say that we have an obligation to keep those we serve informed and engaged. If meeting that obligation is important during what we would consider normal times, it is certainly essential during this unprecedented pandemic. This public health crisis is unlike anything we have ever seen before. In Baltimore County, we have 4,058 confirmed COVID-19 cases, 218 deaths secondary to COVID-19. Additionally, 167 of our deaths are related to our congregate care, specifically our nursing homes. African Americans make up 30% of our county population, but approximately 50% of the number of confirmed cases. Likewise, Hispanics make up 6% of the county population, but approximately 12% of the number of confirmed cases. We are working aggressively with local, state, and federal partners to contain transmission of the virus, improve outcomes, and for the most severe, severely affected, and mitigate the overall impact of COVID-19 is having on our communities. I'm gonna talk a little bit about testing. In a little more than 2 weeks, the Baltimore County Department of Health opened 4 testing sites across the county. These sites are convenient, accessible, and located in areas with high case counts. As a result, testing is now available in the county 5 days a week. And this weekend will be our first Saturday site at the Timonium Fairgrounds. As we secure more testing kits, we look to increase testing availability across the county. This is very important because testing helps to limit the number of potential exposures that might otherwise occur. Limiting potential exposures helps to contain the spread of the disease. Now, in our congregate care facilities, we continue to support our community health partners and the congregate care facilities like nursing homes. Ensuring the health and safety of residents as well as the staff in these facilities is a major focus. As supplies become available, we are providing personal protective equipment to these institutions. Additionally, we are working with them to implement guidance from the CDC. Yesterday, we began a community outreach initiative that focused on providing COVID-19 safety kits in underserved communities. Over the coming weeks, we will distribute these COVID-19 safety kits at our test sites and at food distribution centers. The kits contain masks, gloves, and educational information about the COVID-19 virus and ways to help contain the spread. Putting these safety kits in the hands of those who most need them will provide an additional layer of protection in our communities where the virus is most prevalent. These actions are just a few we are taking in the fight against the virus. I want everyone to remember that this is a marathon and not a sprint. However, it is a race that we can and will win, especially if we all remember we have to play our part. So what is your part? We've got to wash our hands frequently, practice social distancing, wear our masks while in retail establishments, cover our cough and sneezes, and please, please, please stay at home if you're feeling sick. Baltimore County is working nonstop to ensure that our staff, our residents, our families, and our pets are protected. We are counting on each of you to do the same. Thank you, and God bless you. Delegate Stein.
Thank you, Dr. Branch, and thanks for all that you and the county executive and the Baltimore County governor are doing to fight the virus in Baltimore County. At the outset, I think you mentioned the number of cases and fatalities from COVID-19 in the county. So one question I have is, what are the trends in Baltimore County regarding new cases and hospitalizations of individuals who are infected with COVID-19?
So the trends in Baltimore County are very similar to other places. What we see is that the nursing home population is the population that we see who are very, very affected by it and who we have the increased number of deaths with. We know that 75% of the deaths in Baltimore County secondary to COVID-19 illness is seen at a person who's affiliated with a nursing home. In addition to that, we've seen the trend that the African-American community, persons of color, those communities are the communities most affected by the COVID-19. And that's why it's so important for us to be able to get the information and the supplies and the protective equipment out to those neighborhoods.
Okay, thank you. And speaking of nursing homes and assisted living facilities, Dr. Branch, you mentioned that the county is making a major effort to get the personal protective gear to those facilities and nursing homes. Are also, in terms of testing of staff and residents, how is that coming? I know that, you know, the governor had made a major push to try to provide testing for all, at least all staff members at nursing homes. Is that happening in Baltimore County yet?
Yes, we are preparing for that. One of the things I think is very important to everyone understands, it is not just simple, let's go in and just test all the residents and all the staff. If you make the assumption that some of the staff are going to be positive, asymptomatic, meaning that they have no symptoms, but they're positive, then they're not going to be able to work in the nursing home. So prior to testing everyone, the nursing home has to get a group of staff that can replace the positive staff before they can do the testing. So we're working with the nursing homes now to ensure that they have enough staff coverage so that when they do the testing, we're not leaving the residents of the nursing homes with no one to take care of them.
Mm. Okay, that makes sense. And Dr. Branch, my last question is about capacity of the hospitals in Baltimore County. With the current level of hospitalizations and anticipated additional hospitalizations that will happen as additional people get infected, are you confident that the hospitals in the county have the capacity to handle additional cases that require intensive care treatment as this pandemic continues?
Yes. So at this particular time, the hospitals have not had any issues with handling the capacity. And we are talking with the hospitals at least twice a week. And so while we are talking with them, we are planning. And so I do not foresee any issues when it comes to capacity at this particular time with the Baltimore County hospitals.
Okay, great. That's good news. Well, thank you, Dr. Branch, for your presentation. And I don't have any further questions at this point, so would like to turn things over to Senator Hedelman.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dana. And I would like now to introduce Dr. Josh Sharfstein. Dr. Sharfstein is the Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. And he also is the former secretary of the Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, as it was called then. Thanks, Dr. Sharfstein, for joining us tonight.
Sure, thanks for having me. I'm happy to give a brief overview of where things are going a little bit more broadly, if that makes sense to you. So first of all, let me thank you all, delegates, Senator, and Dr. Branch, who's was a fantastic colleague of mine when I was working at the state and the city level, for the chance to come here. I have a chance at the School of Public Health to work with a number of different states at all kinds of different stages of the pandemic. And there's some sort of common themes and of course, a lot of regional differences. Right now, we're at this point in many places where we have breathed a little bit of a sigh of relief. It's been a very, very difficult and painful process. But we, because of the stay-at-home orders, we've avoided the catastrophic scenarios of the healthcare system being overwhelmed with patients with the coronavirus. And that's certainly true in this area, as Dr. Branch just said. It's true in the rest of the country. New York got the closest to the brink and is now dealing with just tremendous loss. But fortunately, the hospitals there are doing better and many more patients are being able to get earlier treatment. So we're now at this point where we've avoided the worst case scenario, but we're left with in many places in this country, including in Maryland, kind of a plateau. Things aren't coming down that quickly. We have a big interest in seeing things get more back to normal. But at the other hand, we know that the virus is waiting for us. And so how are we able to do those things as safely as possible? What can we do? And so the first thing is to be careful not to open too soon. And I think the governor waiting for a clear declining trend is the right thing to do before opening. You also want to make sure that the hospitals have adequate capacity, which, as Dr. Branch pointed out, they do in this area right now. It's very important that there be adequate capacity to respond to cases through contact tracing, isolation, and quarantine in order to be able to manage spread of the virus without having to resort to shutting things down. And then you have to go slowly. You have to really make sure people understand that the only thing that kept us from that catastrophic scenario is we stayed away from each other physically. And if we're not careful, then we could see the virus spread even worse than it did before. And that means in all of our personal interactions and when business is open, it's really important to be thinking about how can we minimize the spread of the virus at every opportunity. And that's really the purpose of going slow. So if we flipped off things very quickly with a, like turning off a light, we like turn the switch, we're now turning things on with a dimmer switch, slowly watching what happens, possibly, you know, going back a little bit just to make sure we don't wind up in a very serious situation. So I think that Baltimore County has done a lot of the right things. You've, you know, it's been a very difficult situation for many people. And I think this is a moment for us to think about how starting slowly again, what that really looks like, how we're going back to a new normal and not the old normal, how we have to keep looking out for each other, how we have to focus on communities that are particularly hard hit, as Dr. Brand said, and figure out what's behind that and fix that as best we can. And just be very careful going into this year. Last thought here, what we're really trying to do is buy time. We're trying to keep things as quiet as possible while there are scientists who are working on treatments and vaccines that will really make an enormous difference. And I know that this is a very stressful time because there's so much uncertainty, but there is so much research, so much scientific activity. This uncertainty will not last forever. If we can just, you know, do our best to keep things in check, as hard as that is, we will see that there are significant advances. And I'll give you one example of a project at Johns Hopkins, which has the possibility of getting some important news this summer. We don't know what it'll be, but just as an example, this is a project that takes antibodies from people who have recovered from the coronavirus and gives it to people who are either sick with the coronavirus or even just at high risk of being sick with the coronavirus. So for example, you could give a small dose to someone who works in a nursing home, and that might actually protect them for 30 or 60 days from getting sick. This is a technology that's more than 100 years old. It was developed for use, for example, in measles. So measles is highly infectious. And there were cases when if a measles got into like a boarding house, everyone would get it. But what they did was they gave the convalescent serum, that's what it's called, the antibodies to people after the first case. So right at the point of exposure, and then nobody else got it. And so they're trying to see whether that same theory will work with the coronavirus. And that's gone from just an idea in the head of one of our professors, Dr. Arturo Casadevall, to a project that was funded by Bloomberg Philanthropies in the state of Maryland, to thousands of people around the country now getting treated and tolerating it quite well, to studies that will actually compare people who get this at different stages with people who don't get this treatment to see whether it actually works. And so That's one of many different things, but we will have some of those results this summer, and that could provide potentially a tool to really protect people in vital jobs and really help us with that reopening process. So I don't think this is a moment for every, you know, there's a lot of loss and sadness and anxiety and fear, but there's also the idea that as we move forward, there will be signs of hope. So maybe I'll stop there, Senator.
Sure. Thank you very much. We do have a number of questions that have come in that I would love to pose to you, some of which you touched on in your remarks. But Governor Hogan's reopening plan requires, he has said, at least 2 weeks of declines in the numbers of new deaths and new hospitalizations and use of intensive care unit beds. And in your opinion, have these benchmarks been reached yet? And if not, when do you, you said that there has been a flattening out, and I think the numbers have indicated that, but it, do you have any sort of predictions about when we might reach some of those milestones?
You know, I'm not a great predictor of the future in that regard. I'm hopeful that, I think right now, particularly in Maryland, you've got a big challenge in the DC area, which is driving a lot of the numbers. I don't know when those milestones will be met, but I do think that it, you know, there have been some declines recently in the number of people hospitalized, and that's a good sign. And hopefully people are, you know, will still stay away from each other physically, reduce the chance of spread. Really, I think that there needs to be a big focus, particularly in the African-American Latino communities. The Latino community has been particularly hard hit and down in Prince George's County. I think those are the focus areas that are going to be able to get the state over the hump.
Okay. So would you then favor a regional approach to reopening? Did you see that?
No? So it's a good question. You know, there are some states that have asked me that question, and I've said definitely a regional approach. These are very big states, you know, with hours and hours of driving between different regions. Maryland is a relatively small state geographically. It doesn't take that long to get from Prince George's County to the Baltimore area. So I think it's a much tougher call to say a regional approach actually here for that reason. So I can understand why the governor might want to wait for statewide metrics, because the risk of doing reopening up here while there's still a big problem in the DC area could be that we suddenly have a bigger problem up here.
Okay. Thank you. Someone else asked, nursing homes, and Dr. Branch mentioned this in his remarks, that nursing homes and assisted living facilities have become the epicenters for COVID-19 cases in this state. And how do you think the state has been responding to those issues? And I'm gonna tack on something to that, is one of the things that has really been mentioned by, I think, almost all of the experts, is the importance of contact tracing, of testing, and PPE, and that those three legs of the stool all need to be very robust and strong and widespread before we can sort of open further. And those, do you feel like those things are in place in those hotbeds?
So why don't we take those questions one at a time, maybe reverse order. So I think, you know, testing is certainly scaling up in Maryland, and it's very important for people who are sick, you know, have symptoms, to be able to get testing very rapidly. I think, you know, and I would defer to Dr. Branch how well he thinks that is available in the county, but I know that there are these testing centers, there are other places people can go. GBMC has testing. There's a fair amount of testing available in the county, so that might be enough, if it, you know, to be able to start to reopen, if you can do that just on that one metric. Contact tracing is very important. And again, I defer to Dr. Branch. I think it's important when you get down to a reasonable number of infections to be able to track them, so you can really slow the spread without having to shut down the economy or do much more drastic things. So I think that is a very important thing. But I think those two things are sort of general. The issue of nursing homes is very specific. And nursing homes need more than just contact tracing. Nursing homes need, when there's an illness, you need a full-scale investigation and a full-scale infection control approach, because what we've seen is just how much danger is there. And that is not just Maryland nursing homes. That is nursing homes across the country. So many deaths in nursing homes. And it's really the nursing home model that has put people at risk, where there are people at very high risk, living in close quarters, and without, you know, at baseline, the routine use of protective equipment and not having that much on hand, has just allowed the coronavirus to really move very freely around. Testing isn't just for the person, it's for pretty much everyone. Once you've got an infection in there, they really need to sort out who's got it, who doesn't, put people together who have it. You know, I'll be honest, I don't think people have really figured out completely how to protect nursing homes. I mean, there's every precaution being taken. They could test people routinely, which I don't think is a bad thing to do, but you know, you could have negative tests one day and then someone could bring it in the next day. So it's a very, very serious issue. I think probably more frequent testing and protective equipment and a lot of infection control precautions, such as, you know, people limiting visitors, having people eat in their rooms and not in common areas. I don't think you can take enough protection right now until we understand more. That's one of the reasons why I'm, you know, really hopeful there's some evidence that comes out for this convalescent serum, because as well as for different kinds of immune issues, like possibly the antibodies being protective, if you can have antibodies, because I think we're gonna have to really figure out how to protect nursing homes better in the future.
So I have two questions related to what you just mentioned, but I also am curious, because you have such a national perspective. I know here in Maryland, some of the special teams and the executive orders have really focused on what our statutory definition is of nursing homes, which does not include other kinds of congregate care facilities like assisted living facilities, yeah, group homes. And is that the case in other states as well?
So it is the larger skilled nursing facilities that are at the greatest risk, because they're the most people who are there and they're living in such close quarters. Assisted living, though, is definitely vulnerable. And I know in Baltimore area, there's a lot of outreach to assisted living. There's a lot of concern. Baltimore City is distributing PPE to assisted living facilities. And even beyond that, senior housing is some place that makes me very concerned. Any place, you know, I did a call early on where they said, you know, do we need to close the bingo rooms? It's like, yes, you know, you need to close the bingo rooms, because even just one person yelling bingo and then you can be spreading the virus. So it's very important that on the one hand, that these, you know, places be recognized to be sources of potential outbreaks. But the other, to realize how hard it is to be shutting all these things down, because, you know, bingo may be something people really look forward to. And the mental health issues of this can be very stressful for people in all of these settings, nursing homes, assisted living, and other congregate living like senior housing.
What actually that was goes to right to a question that someone asked on the Facebook page is, what can be done to address the mental health issues? And we'll get this, I think, have a different discussion later with the person from, Caitlin from NAMI. But can you talk a little bit about the mental health issues around people who are providing essential care and the frontline health workers?
Sure, these are all very important. You know, one thing that we've done at Johns Hopkins, we started a podcast called Public Health on Call that people can, you know, if they're into podcasts, can look up on any podcast platform. And we've done some really compelling podcasts around this issue, mental health issues in general, but particularly mental health of first responders and healthcare workers. The amount of stress that people are under is just really remarkable. And unfortunately, the distancing that we require makes it hard for people to get the kind of support that they usually get. So it's a double whammy, very stressful situation, and the kinds of supports that are usually there may be much harder to go by. So it's really important for people to get different kinds of support that can be, first of all, recognition in their workplace, appreciation from their workplace, support in the form of counseling and other things from their workplace. And Johns Hopkins has a special program, I think it's called RISE, that is aimed to build resilience in stressful situations for healthcare workers, very important. And also recognizing the signs and symptoms of depression, anxiety, and other conditions that can develop so that people can get good treatment for that. It's also important, you know, to recognize the stress that their families are under. It is just enormously stressful, because this is a disease. People aren't just worried about getting sick themselves, they're worried about getting their family members sick. And sometimes people have taken to, you know, at a minimum, you know, taking a shower right when they get home and not hugging their kids, but maybe even sleeping in different places and being physically distant, and all those things can be enormously stressful. So I think this is a time when the healthcare system really needs to go the extra mile for healthcare workers, and all of us need to understand the stress that they're under in different ways.
Thank you. A couple other questions that you touched on earlier. Can you talk a little bit about the development of a vaccine and the prospects of that, as well as a test for the antibody and what that would mean?
Sure. So the goal of a vaccine would be to build immunity in the population so that the virus has no place to go. And, you know, for a long time, we had that in the United States for measles until it kind of crept back in because some people decided not to vaccinate their kids. But, you know, measles, another horrible disease, which a vaccine pretty much eradicated for a while from the United States. That's the goal for COVID, to have a vaccine that makes it impossible for the virus to move from person to person. There are a lot of different ideas out there for how to make a COVID vaccine. And there are many different candidate vaccines in development, some of which have already entered some early clinical trials. I would describe them as like old school vaccines and new school vaccines. So the old school vaccines, they take the virus, they kill the virus, and they give you the virus as a vaccine. That's a, like a very common old type of vaccine, and that may well work. So that's gonna, that there are some people developing that. There are other kinds of vaccine. There's different kinds of live vaccines. There's also some very innovative technologies where instead of giving, you know, the concept of a vaccine is you give a piece of the virus or a part of the virus to someone so their immune system recognizes it and has antibodies so that when the actual virus comes in, the immune system is ready and pounces on the virus and the virus never takes hold. That's how most vaccines work. Some of these new technologies are very creative. They don't actually give the piece of the virus, they give the piece of the genetic code of the virus, and they expect the person's own cells to express that piece of the virus, so it's even a better and stronger response. So that those types of viruses are being tested. So there are even virus vaccines, so those types of vaccines are being tested. There are even vaccines that are neither A nor B, and are just general vaccines that are not even specific to COVID, but with the idea that they might actually make the immune system response stronger. And so the tuberculosis vaccine called BCG has been used, is being studied to see whether it might actually work against COVID, even though it's not specific for COVID, on the theory that it might help the immune system response. So there's a lot of research going on. There are also a lot of competition among the different labs, which in general is good. But what I don't like about it is when one lab says, like, we're going to have a great vaccine by September. You know, until they do the scientific studies, they don't know whether they're going to have a great vaccine by September. And I think, you know, it's okay to say we're moving as fast as we can and we hope to have some results by September, but you don't want to overly raise people's hopes. There's a lot of steps to making a safe and effective vaccine. First, you've got to find a safe and effective vaccine. You've got to be very careful about testing it because you're going to be giving it to a lot of healthy people. It's got to be very, very safe. So there are a number of steps to really make sure that a vaccine is ready to use. So I think while there's been a tremendous amount of scientific activity and I think people are very hopeful of vaccine, it probably won't be as fast as the fastest predictions, and maybe a while before, even if we find a great vaccine, that it can be made in the quantities that are necessary to really protect the world. So that's the vaccine question, which is promising. Lots of technologies, lots of things we're learning about the virus, which also make it promising that there would be a successful vaccine. But until you have one, you know, you're waiting. And I think what we need to do is get time for the scientists to work on vaccines. Antibody testing is available. There are two issues with antibody testing. One is, does the test measure whether you have antibodies? In other words, is it a good test? The other is, what does it mean that you have antibodies? So for the first question, there are more than 100 tests that you can buy. There are only a small number of them that are very accurate. So hopefully the Food and Drug Administration will take the other ones off the market and there'll just be a little bit of a greater assurance that you're actually, you know, finding antibodies if the test says you have antibodies. So that's one thing. So that the market has to sort out a little bit. But we think that the good tests will drive out the bad tests, that the FDA will get more active, and that the manufacturers of the good tests will make a lot more. So in a few weeks to months, I think we're going to have a lot more antibody tests available in this country. The second question, though, is how much does having antibodies mean that you're protected from future infections? And this is obviously a pretty big question. I would say there is a hope and even an expectation in the scientific community that having antibodies would confer some degree of protection. And that's based on the fact, particularly for antibodies called neutralizing antibodies, that in general for viral infections signify protection. We don't know this for sure until there's more research that's done. But it is quite possible that some people will be relatively protected from the COVID vaccine, which would obviously be good news. It would also mean that that's a good sign that a vaccine is possible to make. If you think about HIV, where people have antibodies, but the antibodies don't prevent infection, that's been one reason why it's very hard to make an HIV vaccine. So we think that the antibodies hopefully will be protective, we'll find that, and that will be consistent with developing a vaccine. So for right now, you know, it's mainly those antibody tests are a sign that you've been infected, but they're not yet a sign that you might be immune. But it's hopeful that we'll get a lot more information about that too.
Okay, thank you. And final question is, how risky is it right now to get non-coronavirus medical issues addressed, especially at hospitals?
It's a great question. I think there's obviously some risk, but the hospitals, particularly in this area, are taking so many different kinds of precautions. I think it'd be important to wear a mask if you're going to the hospital, to call ahead, to figure out, you know, exactly what you need to do to minimize your risk. But there are some very serious issues that people have that need to be taken care of. And we don't want people dying of other things because they're afraid of the coronavirus. We want people to get the care for those things. So I think it would be important to talk it over with your doctor. And probably it will make sense to get care if you take the right precautions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sharfstein. It's really an honor, a pleasure to hear your insights and answer those questions so comprehensively. We are now going to hear from Caitlin Mulrine, who will discuss mental health concerns due to the virus. As has already been indicated, she works at the Baltimore chapter of the National Alliance on Mental Illness, and we look forward to hearing from her.
Thank you so much, Delegate Cardin and the entire District 11 team for having me and for the warm welcome this evening. Good evening. I'm really happy to be here to share information about the mental health challenges resulting from COVID-19. As Delegate Cardin noted, I work with NAMI, Metropolitan Baltimore. We are an affiliate of the National Alliance on Mental Illness, which is the nation's largest grassroots mental health organization. Our local chapter here serves all of Baltimore City and Baltimore County. The ongoing public health emergency, I think, has really highlighted the importance of taking care of our mental health. But it's also presented a lot of new challenges in doing so. A new study I found through San Diego State and Florida State Universities found that 70% of Americans reported experiencing moderate to severe mental distress just since the pandemic began. And we're also seeing an influx of calls to both national and local crisis lines since March. There's a number of issues that I want to, you know, briefly talk through that are contributing to this. The first one has come up throughout this webinar is the isolation that is created by physical distancing. And this can lead to feelings of loneliness, and that lack of connection can really weigh on our mental health. The next concern is really that disruption that people are experiencing. Most of us are out of our typical routine and habits, and those can be challenging to recreate in this new situation of physical distancing. This can lead a lot of people to feel like they have a lack of control over their circumstances, and that presents a lot of stress and anxiety on us. One of the other issues is, of course, the uncertainty of the situation, not knowing what to expect, And along with that, there's of course the fear about your own health and worrying about the health of your loved ones through the pandemic. And the final, you know, stressor that I want to talk about are those life stresses. So unfortunately, many in our community are facing job loss and other financial challenges that have kind of stemmed from the economic crisis of the pandemic. And that adds tremendous stress and anxiety onto people in our community. For others who have been able to adapt and work from home, there's other challenges that come with that as well in trying to manage a healthy work-life balance when your office moves into your home. And then finally, one more example, many parents in our community accepted the role of homeschool teacher really overnight and are balancing and juggling that on top of all of these other stressors and challenges that they're facing at this time. And so I think it's really important to remind ourselves that it's normal to feel the stress and anxiety because of all of these compounding issues as a result of COVID-19. And it's also important for us to be patient with ourselves and acknowledge that we're in a unique and unprecedented event that none of us have experienced before. And when we think about the 1 in 5 people in our community who live with a mental health condition, the pandemic is only amplifying and exacerbating those existing mental health challenges that they're facing. Individuals living with mental illness often rely on routine and connection as important components of their recovery. And this can be particularly challenging to stay on track and maintain those coping strategies at this time, but it's also more important now for them than ever before. The good news is that there are a lot of resources available in the community, including support services that NAMI can provide that are there for you should you find yourself in need of mental health care or some extra assistance. I know that I'm going to be short on time, so I'm going to stop there and I can share some more details on those resources during the Q&A.
Thank you very much, Caitlin. And we do have a bunch of questions, so hopefully you can interject some more of your thoughts as we go forward. First of all, what resources are available for those who may be facing mental health stresses? You mentioned there's a lot of resources. If maybe you want to go into a couple.
Sure. Yeah. So I will start with some of the resources that are available through NAMI Metro Baltimore to community members right here. We are here and able to offer support. Like every other organization, we're working to adapt our services to physical distancing requirements. So we're now offering our free confidential support groups virtually over Zoom. Our current schedule includes weekly support group meetings for people who live with a mental health condition, as well as a family support group that's open to caregivers and loved ones. We know that families provide really important and critical support, and they can make incredible differences in the outcomes of recovery for their loved ones just by lending their support. So we know that families need their own support as well. Our support groups are all led by trained volunteers with lived experience, so they understand the impact of mental health challenges firsthand. To see a full schedule of services, visit namibaltimore.org, or you can also contact our helpline. I think it'll be shared at the end of this presentation. It's 410-435-2600. And then I also want to touch on some other resources. You may be finding yourself in need of some more clinical support and mental health care. Maybe you've become disconnected from the services that you were receiving before, or maybe you're finding that you need some extra help as a result of kind of all of the disruption of COVID-19. So there's a number of options available for telehealth and teletherapy services at the moment. I'll just touch on a few. Shepherd Pratt is offering a virtual walk-in clinic. You can schedule an appointment from their website and get connected into services that way. If you have a private insurance or employer-provided insurance, you can always touch base with them to find what telehealth services are available in your network. And then finally, you know, many people have through their company an employee assistance program, and many of those programs provide really fantastic benefits, including consultations, mental health support, and can also refer you to other services. And lastly, I just want to touch on, for those who find themselves without health insurance coverage at this time, there is a special open enrollment period open now through June 15th. You can go to Maryland Health Connection to learn more, compare plans, and find the coverage that will work for you.
Thank you very much. Quite comprehensive answer. I'm gonna try and squeeze three more questions in. Two more questions we're gonna put to. First of all, we heard Dr. Sharfstein talk a little bit about frontline workers, healthcare workers. But if you can give your insights on healthcare workers, grocery store workers, postal workers, how they're faring, and if there's any insights you may have about how they should be dealing with mental health.
Sure. Yeah, our frontline workers have really selflessly responded in this health emergency. And in doing so, they've also taken on a high amount of personal risk for themselves. Since we're really still right in the center of this crisis, the full extent of that mental health impact, I think, is still yet to be seen. But I think we can anticipate, especially for those frontline healthcare workers who are processing fatigue and anxiety and grief as they're losing patients, that they may anticipate experiencing higher levels of post-traumatic stress disorder and other mental health conditions. I'll touch on a couple of other resources that are available. The crisis text line, I think, is a fantastic resource. They've opened a specific line for frontline workers. You can text just the word frontline to 741-741, and you'll immediately be connected with a crisis counselor. And then I think, you know, Dr. Sharfstein touched on this as well. Employers making those resources and counseling services available. But I think it's also important for those employers to be thinking through how they can create a culture within their company, the hospital, wherever it may be, that is stigma-free, that really encourages those workers to feel comfortable and safe coming forward to use those services. I think that's going to be really critical moving forward.
Thank you. I'm going to try and put the last two questions together because they're somewhat related, but you only have a couple minutes to do it. This comes from somebody who says, I'm a AARP volunteer, and we are very pleased that you recognize the importance of mental health as well as physical health. Needs vary. What do you think about the special needs of older adults and how do you think that they should be addressed? And the next question is, I'm sure that you are concerned about older adults who are isolated or disabled, but please consider our strengths and skills as older adults. What are some thoughts you might have about how we can contribute moving forward?
Yeah, those are fantastic questions. So I'll take the first one, which was related to what are the particular needs of the older adult community. And since we've already talked about, you know, older adults, especially those with other underlying health conditions, are at a greater risk of a more serious or life-threatening case of COVID-19. And that can add additional stress and anxiety. On top of this, physical distancing can really be amplified for older adults. Family and friends aren't able to visit and check in with them, and that can lead to a lot of loneliness. I think the most important thing is for older adults to stay connected as much as possible with family, friends, and their greater community. There's a number of resources that have opened up specific to older adults. I'll just touch on one since I know we're short on time. The Baltimore Neighbors Network has created a virtual community of volunteers. So older adults can sign up to receive calls from a neighbor. They'll get a call from a trained volunteer. It's really just someone to be there as a listening ear and to provide that connection and conversation. And then the second question was about how can older adults contribute and share with their community? I think that's a fantastic question. And I think one of the best ways is to get involved and volunteer with a community or nonprofit organization. Depending on what types of skills you have to offer, what your interests are, I think you'll find a volunteer opportunity for you in the community, whether that's mentorship, leading a support group at NAMI, making masks for frontline workers, or being available for the call program that I mentioned before. I'll share one final resource, volunteermatch.org is a great place to find all of those virtual volunteer opportunities.
Thank you very much. Now I'll pass it over to Delegate Belcastro.
Caitlin, thank you so much for all your wonderful work at NAMI and for this valuable information that will assist those living with mental illness during these difficult times. Next, we're going to hear from the Census Coordinator for Baltimore County, Sevetra Peoples. Thank you, Sevetra, for taking this time to talk to District 11 about the 2020 Census and its importance.
Good evening. Thank you, Senator Hedelman and Delegates Belcastro, Stein, and Cardin, for inviting me to speak about the 2020 Census. We are currently living in unprecedented times, and while unfortunate, it is an example of why census data is so important. In addition to the determination of congressional seats and redistricting, when we consider funding for programs such as the block grants for the prevention and treatment of substance abuse, unemployment assistance, Medicaid and Medicare Part B assistance, low-income energy assistance, education, business, and industrial loans, and food and nutrition programs, just to name a few, their allocations are based on and determined by the census count. The census is easy, safe, and important. It can be completed online by visiting my2020census.gov. It can be completed by phone by dialing 1-844-330-2020, and it can be completed via paper copy. For those residents who haven't yet completed their 2020 census online, they will automatically receive a paper copy. Under Title 13 of the U.S. Code, the Census Bureau cannot release any identifiable information about you, your household, or your business, even to law enforcement agencies. For every person who goes uncounted in Baltimore County is a loss of $1,800 for that person. Unfortunately, history has shown us that our seniors, those who are age 60 and over, our children under age 5, renters, those who speak English as a secondary language, and the homeless are often undercounted, which means that they are often underserved. Baltimore County's population is predicted to have an increase by 12% from the year 2000. That means that we beautiful Baltimoreans who deserve to live, age, and play safely, soundly, and confidently, we have to ensure that we are indeed counted. Our county executive, Olszewski Jr., stated in the first ever Baltimore County Government Strategic Plan that we will only succeed in this work if we are honest about where we must do more to live up to our potential. Well, I challenge each of us to be honest about the importance of the 2020 census and do more by advocating to family, friends, and neighbors about the importance of the 2020 census. You can do this by posting messages on social media, sending a reminder text message, or calling or mentioning the 2020 census while you're on the phone with family and friends. Lastly, if you or someone you know would like to assist in handing out promotional materials, or if you have questions, we can best be reached at 2020census@baltimorecountymd.gov. Thank you.
Sevetra, thank you. We have a couple of questions for you, if you don't mind. The first question that I have is, will census takers be going to people's homes during the pandemic?
Yes. So the current plan is for census takers who who are also referred to as enumerators, will go out to people's homes beginning June 14th through July 29th. I also want to point out that group quarters will also take place beginning July 1st through September 3rd. Group quarters include those working with our colleges, campuses to ensure that students are captured, the homeless, domestic violence centers, and long-term care facilities.
So I guess with COVID being at the forefront, with people going to individuals' homes or census takers going to people's homes, are there any safety precautions that the census takers will be taking to make sure that they're protecting themselves and also the people that they're coming into contact with when they're going to their homes?
Yes. And so it's also important to remember that the census takers are U.S. Census federal workers, as opposed to Baltimore County workers.
Okay.
But we've been working closely with our area census office and have been informed that they will indeed receive PPE.
Okay. Wonderful. You might have mentioned this already, but if you can just emphasize this, what is the deadline now for responding to the census?
Yes, so the deadline for responding to the 2020 census has been extended to October 31st, 2020. As I mentioned, there are three ways to complete the census that are online by visiting my2020census.gov. And I believe this is, up on folks' screen. It can be completed by phone by visiting 1-844-330-2020. And it can be completed via paper copy.
And then, Sevetra, I just have one more question for you. So since the census is being delayed, how is this going to affect information getting back to the states for deciding redistricting?
So the timeline for decision on redistricting has indeed been affected by COVID-19. Okay. Census Bureau experts will run and review programs to populate any missing demographic data for each household that responded to the census. They'll also run differential privacy programs to ensure confidentiality and run tabulation programs for each state delivery. The revised timeline for this is May 1st, 2021 through July 31st, 2021. By law, the U.S. Census Bureau will deliver the local counts each state needs to complete legislative redistricting by July 31st, 2021.
Sevetra, thank you so much. You've given us a lot of really great information. For now, I'm going to pitch it back to Delegate Dana Stein to wrap things up.
Thank you. Thank you, Lisa and Sevetra. I want to thank all the presenters who joined us tonight, Dr. Branch, Dr. Sharfstein, Sevetra, and Caitlin. And, you know, I think what's been made clear is that our public health and mental health systems are working so very hard on our behalf to get us through this crisis. And, you know, I've got to say that it's very heartening and very encouraging. And also want to thank Sevetra. It's very clear that the county is working very hard to make sure that Baltimore County is fully and accurately represented in the 2020 census. So with that, I'll just turn things over to my colleagues and ask if they'd like to make any closing remarks.
Yes, Dana Stein, Delegate Stein, if you don't mind. I want to take a moment to plug really quick, again, our town hall that we're going to be hosting on Tuesday, May 26th. The focus is going to be on education and the election that is coming up. And then lastly, I want to thank all of the elected officials that came on and watched. We had Councilman Izzy Patoka, thank you for joining us. We had Board of Education member Cheryl Pastor, and you did a great job contributing to the conversation in the chat. Thank you for that. And Central Committee member Linda Dorsey Walker, thank you everyone for joining us tonight.
I have nothing to add except to say thank you to everybody for doing a great job.
Uh, Senator Hedelman, anything
you'd like to add? Participate in the census, and it's really important that, because that will affect how the kinds of resources that we're able to get in Baltimore County and in District 11. So if you haven't filled out your census form, go online or call the number that she mentioned. And I just think that it's so important, the issues that we were talking about tonight and the very real physical and mental health struggles and challenges that people are facing today. So I'd like to thank all of the participants. I'd also like to thank our staff, who was really helpful in putting this all together. That's Tyler and Marilyn and Mara and Molly and Margie. So thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you, Shelley. And I'll echo your thanks to everyone who helped put together this town hall. And for folks who've joined in, the contact information for the panelists is listed. And also just a reminder that we in District 11 are always available to help out with any issues related to COVID-19, be it the health issues, mental health issues, the unemployment or small business assistance issues that we discussed 2 weeks ago, and certainly any other issue, constituent issue. So with that, and here is our contact information for getting in touch with us. So with that, I'll say thank you and have a good night to everyone.